I do want to ask about this whole info overload problem that a lot of our listeners, me included, experience. So do you have some hands-on kind of tips when it comes to knowing what is legit peer-reviewed research and knowing what's BS?
It's tough. Over the years, I've had all myself to go through all the sources of evidence and have to do this triage and find out what's believable and what's not. So I think one thing that is a relatively straightforward distinction is you got to choose your sources. All opinions are not worth the same. And sometimes this is called appeal to authority. But I mean, we do this all the time. If you have a condition and you need surgery, you go to a surgeon. You don't go to your buddy who's really good with his hands, right? We go to specialists who do it for a living. It doesn't mean they're God. It doesn't mean they're always right. But there is something about expertise in a field. If you do it for a living and you're around people who do it for a living and there's a level of supervision, right? There is something to that. So choosing your sources, what I mean is evidence-based, right? It has to come from research literature published in peer-reviewed journals. Now, this is not going to get you rid of all bad advice, but at least it's a start. If you read a random blog or you hear the random opinion of a celebrity or sometimes even people with advanced degrees, sometimes even it could be an MD or a PhD who's just giving an opinion, always ask yourself, what's the source? Is there a scientific peer-reviewed study that this person is referencing? And if so, can I go double check the information? Does it make sense? And I think that's a really good start. And if the advice is not based on science, not evidence-based, then it's worth very little. It's just a random opinion. It's not the same as an expert telling you the results from compiling decades of research. So that's one entry point.
Fantastic. Yeah. I mean, also, we could do a whole episode on that, how to detect BS, pseudoscience,
yes,
non-peer-reviewed information.
Absolutely. And it gets tricky because in peer-reviewed research, you can find all kinds of things that are not the highest standard of science. And one thing that's becoming more and more mainstream knowledge now is that there's a lot of research that is funded by industry, for example.
Yes.
The most notorious abuses of this tend to come from the egg board, the dairy industry, and sometimes the beef industry. Regardless of who's funding it, whether it's almonds or big broccoli or big dairy, whoever it is, if you have a study that's funded by an industry and that's showing a result that's contrary to all the existing literature, and that's removing the guilt of that industry, I mean, that is incredibly suspicious. I am not saying that every study who's funded by industry is false. I'm saying that if it goes against all the research that is not industry funded, that's very suspicious. Interpret it with a huge grain of salt.
Yes, absolutely.
These people are not monsters. It's just they have a very clear goal, and their goal is to sell their product. And they're going to do whatever it takes to sell that product. Our job is to make sure, to the extent that it's possible, to separate science from business interests. The people organizing these guidelines and in charge of telling the population what's the healthiest food should not be people who served for industry, should not be people on their payroll, should not be people that are somehow tied to these financial interests. I think that's the key. And to be honest, it is moving in that direction. Canada is an obvious example. We should applaud that. And it was highly publicized this week and highly applauded by all the leaders of evidence-based medicine. But in the US, it's also moving in that direction. Small steps, but it's generally getting there.